Hi, I'm Alex, and welcome to Super Make Something Basics. Today, we take a look at multi-material 3D printing with help from the KiDiTech X Pro. Capabilities of home 3D printers have increased significantly over the years, and now allow makers to rapid prototype their designs at home in a wide variety of colors and materials. Since 2016, machines capable of printing with multiple materials simultaneously have also become widely available for hobbyist use. This further increases the ability to manufacture complex models at your desk by allowing users to do things like creating prints that have both hard and soft components in one model without requiring any manual assembly, and by printing models with complicated internal geometries by using dissolvable support materials. Solutions for printing with multiple materials exist both for machines with single and multiple print nozzles, though both approaches have their own advantages. Like their name suggests, single nozzle solutions feed all of your material for a print through a single nozzle, which requires each material to be purged out of the nozzle after use. Oftentimes, this is done using a prime tower, a small, disposable structure that is built up during the printing process along with the model, and which is composed of mixed material dispensed from a nozzle during a material change. Since only one nozzle is used to build the entire model, printing with single nozzle printers is easier because bed leveling is easier, but printing with multiple material types is more difficult, especially if materials in the model have significantly different printing temperatures. Multi-nozzle solutions, the most common of which are dual extruder printers, have multiple extruders that are heated and controlled independently, which makes printing multiple material types easier, but they're more difficult to level and require an ooze shield to be built around a print in order to catch material oozing out of the inactive nozzle during a print job. Oftentimes, dual extruder printers are also direct drive printers, meaning that the extrusion motor is located on the print carriage. This makes it easier to print compliant materials like NinjaFlex and TPU compared to machines that use a Boden extruder, where extrusion motors are located elsewhere on the printer. All of this being said, both types of multi-material printing require special preparation, which is a bit more involved than printing single material models. To further explore multi-material 3D printing, KiDiTech generously sent me their X-Pro 3D printer. The KiDiTech X-Pro is a dual extruder FDM machine featuring direct drive extruders, a completely enclosed build volume, a 4.3 inch color touchscreen, integrated LED lighting, and a 9.1 by 5.9 by 5.9 inch build volume. One of the coolest features about this printer is that it uses magnets to both attach its flexible print surface to the print bed, as well as its side panels to the printer's frame, meaning that they can be easily removed from the machine in order to access models after they are printed. The printer itself arrived in a well-packaged box and contained everything that is needed to start printing quickly, including a hard shell case with tools and replacement parts, two magnetic print surfaces, and two full-sized rolls of printing filament, one roll of red PLA and one roll of white ABS. The setup itself was also very straightforward and simply requires a user to remove the printer's plastic wrapping and foam inserts and then install the printhead onto the pre-installed carriage using a few screws. Because the printer's side panels are removable, accessing the carriage for installation was easy, but it was a bit tricky to film. Luckily, KiDiTech also includes a flash drive with the printer, which not only contains various sample print files, but also contains instructional videos that guide you through each step of the setup process. After attaching the filament guide tubes to the mounting brackets on the back of the printer and inserting one of their ends into each print head, I next mounted two PLA rolls onto the spool holders on the back of the unit, plugged in the power cord, placed the printing enclosure lid on the top of the machine, and turned on the printer. Leveling was done via a guided multi-point manual leveling procedure that is standard on most printers, but KiDiTech includes a flexible leveling sheet with each of their units to precisely space the print head above the print bed, which I thought was pretty cool. After leveling, I preheated each extruder using the printer's responsive touchscreen, finally using the extrusion jog controls to get filament to extrude out of each nozzle, after which the printer was all set up. It was now time to create my first multi-material print. For this, I first opened up Fusion 360, a free computer-aided design software package from Autodesk. There, I created a YouTube subscribe button that contained a red base, as well as a white logo, lettering, and outer border. The key detail behind creating multi-material 3D prints is that the slicing software used to generate G-code to control the 3D printer treats each material as a separate body. As such, I next navigated to the Bodies folder in the Fusion 360 browser and hid the red base by clicking on the eye icon next to this component's body. After this, I right-clicked on the model's file name at the top of the browser and then exported the visible bodies using the Save as STL menu option. This saved all bodies that were still visible into a single STL file. and then repeated these steps to separately export the model's red base. I next opened up KittyPrint, a Cura-derived 3D slicing program provided by KittyTech, which was included on the flash drive that came with the printer. Being a Cura derivative, the slicing software is incredibly functional and comes with pre-configured profiles for each of KittyTech's printers, but because it is based on an older version of Cura, it does not contain any of Cura's latest features. I did reach out to KittyTech to ask if they would be able to supply a printer configuration file so that the machine could be used with newer versions of Cura, and they responded extremely quickly, providing both a .3MF printer profile and installation instructions. In case you're interested in using this printer with newer versions of Cura, you can find links to both of these items in the video description below. In the KittyPrint software, I first navigated to the settings menu and made sure that the X Pro was selected as the printer. I next imported the red base, rotated it so that it laid flat on the build plate, and scaled it to 80% of its size. After this, I imported all of the white components, again rotating and scaling them, and ensuring that alignment of these bodies was the same as it was in Fusion 360. The easiest way to do this is to use the Center Model on Platform option, which can be accessed by right-clicking in the slicing window. This option will align the models perfectly because they were generated from the same Fusion 360 model and therefore each share the same origin. I next selected each model in the slicing window and used the extruder option to select which extruder each body should be printed with. This may require you to also use the move option to translate the parts around the print bed so that you can select them easily, but these can then be realigned using the center model on platform option. Bodies printed with each extruder will be highlighted in a different color, allowing you to easily verify that everything is set up correctly. I next navigated to the settings button at the top of the screen to ensure that my printing temperature, build plate temperature, and print speed were set correctly, and then also made sure that the enable prime tower and enable ooze shield options were selected under the dual extrusion heading for each extruder. Finally, I clicked on the prepare button at the bottom of the screen, which sliced the model and allowed me to save the generated G-code to a flash drive. To print the model, I plugged the flash drive into the side of the machine, navigated to the G-code file using the printer's touchscreen, and then clicked the print button, after which the model started printing. As far as first impressions go, I was extremely impressed with the printer. Not only were both printheads perfectly leveled, showing that the dual extruder nozzle alignment from the factory was perfect, but the pre-configured printer settings within KittyPrint also seemed to be tuned extremely well. Because of the enclosed build volume, there were no odors released from the printer during operation, and the built-in LED light made monitoring the print incredibly easy. After the print completed, I was able to easily remove the magnetic build plate and then simply flex it a bit, which caused everything to pop off the printing surface without any issue. At this point, I have to say that the print quality of the X Pro is amazing. Based on things I read about dual extrusion printing online, I was expecting there to be at least some stringing on my print's outer surfaces because of filament ooze from the inactive print nozzle, but there was absolutely none. Lettering was extremely crisp, and the surface finish of the print was one of the best I've ever seen, even compared to all of my single extruder printers. Encouraged by these results, I got ready for my next test, but before moving on, if you like this video, please consider doing as the print says and subscribe to the channel. Giving the video a like and sharing it with your friends is also appreciated, as this helps Super make something reach a larger audience. But what about printing existing STL files in multiple colors? Downloadable models on sites like Thingiverse are generally made up of a single STL file. These models must therefore first be split into multiple bodies before they can be printed as multi-material objects. To do this, I used MeshMixer, a free mesh modification software also made by Autodesk. Here, I first opened up a Mario Kart Blue Shell STL file that I had downloaded on Thingiverse by clicking on the import button on the left side of the screen. A link to this model can be found in the video description below. In this particular case, the origin of the model was in the middle of the mesh, which resulted in half of it being located below the print bed. Since this could cause problems in being able to correctly place each body when I would later import it into the Kitty slicing software, I first relocated the origin by translating the model by going to Edit, Align, and clicking OK using the default options. In MeshMixer, bodies are selected using a virtual paintbrush, which can be accessed by clicking on the Select button on the left menu bar. With the cursor displayed, I next painted one of the model's spikes, making sure to adjust the crease angle threshold option as necessary under the Filters tab to make sure that my selection would not accidentally bleed into the turtle's shell. After I had fully selected the spike, I navigated to the Modify Smooth Boundary option, which drew a blue bounding line based on my selection at the bottom of the spike. After verifying that everything looked good, I clicked the accept button and observed that this had refined my selection and made the model selection boundary nice and smooth. Next, I headed back to the modify menu and clicked the create face group option, which created a group out of my current selection. I then repeated this for each of the spikes in the model. Overall, the selection process definitely takes a while, and depending on the complexity of the model you're trying to split, it may not be possible to process everything in one session. Not to worry though, as MeshMixer files can be saved as a .mix file by using the save option under the file menu, which allows you to close your model and resume the splitting process later. Once all of the bodies had been split into separate face groups, it was time to save out individual STL files. To do this, I headed back to the edit menu and clicked on Generate Complex. After this, I double-clicked on the boundary line of one of the face groups that I had created, and then clicked Auto-Generate, which then split the mesh into separate bodies. After verifying that the files were split correctly, I selected the complex object in the newly generated object browser window, and then clicked on the Split Complex option on the left side of the screen. This split each of the spikes into a separate object. To make importing and alignment of each component in the slicing software easier, I next selected each of the spike objects in the object browser window, and clicked on the Combine menu option to recombine these files into a single group. With the combined file selected, I then clicked on the Export option on the left side of the screen, made sure that the STL option was selected as the file type, named my file, and clicked Save. With the spikes exported separately, it was time to process the rest of the model. For this, I first selected the complex that corresponded to the spikes, hit it, selected the remaining complex, and then repeated all of the previous steps to select and separately export sections of the turtle shell that I wanted to print in a separate color. After I had separated all of the shells, I then finally exported the remaining body as a single STL file as well. It was now again time to slice the files. For this, I opened up Kidi Print and then headed to Preferences, Configure Kidi. In this menu, I made sure that Automatically Drop Models to the Build Plate and Scale Large Models were both unchecked. Next, I opened up each model, scaled each of them to 25% of their original size, and then carefully lined everything up using the Center on Build Plate and Translate tools. Finally, I again selected which extruder would print which body, sliced everything, and exported the model to my flash drive. The printing process was again extremely straightforward, and the model was printed successfully without any issues. Even though this model was significantly more complicated to print than the previous model, because it both used support material and had significant overhangs because of the spikes, every component, including the Prime Tower and U-Shield, again printed perfectly. The resulting model was extremely smooth, and only a bit of curling happened on one side of the color transitions on the shell, which was most likely due to a small alignment error on my part when positioning the separate models in the slicing software. Support material also came off relatively cleanly, and unsupported overhangs printed without a problem. Like the subscribe sign, the blue shell print was a huge success. It was now time to test one of the main reasons to use a dual extrusion printer, being able to print with dissolvable supports. For this, I picked up a roll of eSun PVA. PVA, or polyvinyl alcohol, is a soft, biodegradable polymer that is commonly used as a dissolvable support material when printing with PLA. This is advantageous both for creating clean, highly detailed prints that have significant overhangs and therefore require a high amount of supports, as well as for printing models with internal geometry where it would be impossible to remove support material after a print. Because PVA is water-soluble though, it also readily absorbs moisture from the air, meaning that it should only be exposed to the environment when actively printing with it. When not in use, it is highly recommended to store PVA in a Ziploc bag that has had all of its air removed, along with the desiccant that originally came with the filament roll. To test out how well PVA works, I first downloaded a model of a Hilbert cube on Thingiverse, which had complicated internal geometry that would be extremely difficult to remove by hand. After opening up the model in Kidi Print, I first verified that the model itself was set to print with the correct extruder, and then headed to the Settings menu, where I then set the support extruder to the one loaded with PVA. I next lowered the printing temperature to 190 degrees Celsius, and decreased the print speed to 10 millimeters per second in order to prevent buckling during extrusion. I next headed to the Preferences Settings menu, where I scrolled down to the Support section, and made sure that both the Support Density and Support Z Distance options were checked. Since I was unsure how well the PVA would stick to the bed, and I did not want the Prime Tower to be knocked over mid-print, I also made sure that the Z-Hop when retracted option under the Travel section was checked, which prevents the printing nozzle from dragging across a part surface by moving it up a small amount when performing non-printing moves. I then headed back to the left extruder settings menu, checked the Z-hop when retracted option for both extruders, changed the support density to 50%, and set the support Z distance to 0 mm. I also changed the build plate adhesion type to brim in order to increase the contact area of the prime tower and minimize its chance of being knocked over mid-print. Finally, I sliced the model, previewed the layers to make sure that everything would print correctly, and exported the G-code to a flash drive. Not gonna lie, printing with PVA is a bit nerve-wracking. Unlike the previous prints, where both extruders were loaded with PLA, printing with two materials is a bit more complicated because they do not like to stick to each other as well as two materials of the same type. This difficulty is amplified when printing thin structures like an U-shield because each layer is only composed of a single bead of material. Compared to the previous prints that used two types of PLA, this multi-material U-shield curled in a few places, making me worry that it would delaminate mid-print and collide with the model. I'm happy to report that the KiDiTech X-Pro handled these challenges without issue and that the nearly 6-hour print job was completed without a hiccup. If you're like me and like to watch your prints as they are running, the best advice I can give you based on these results is to simply walk away from your printer after it has started building and trust the process. Despite the brim, the print was again easily removed from the printing surface. The brim also separated from the model quickly, and I was able to easily clean up any remaining flashing with an X-Acto knife. To dissolve the PVA, I next submerged the model in a small container filled with lukewarm water and gently swished it around the container for about a minute. To help the process along a bit, I also used some pliers to remove the waterlogged support material, though this is optional as PVA is completely water-soluble and should fall off the model without any extra help if given enough time. Finally, I washed off the clean model in a bit of fresh water to remove any PVA residue. Like the other prints, the Hilbert Cube turned out amazingly well. Unlike single material prints, absolutely no nubs remained on the final model and interior faces had an essentially perfect finish. Some stringing was present in the internal geometry, but this could easily be fixed by applying a bit of heat to the model during post-processing. The KiDiTech X-Pro seemed to have zero issues with printing PVA, and because of the perfect alignment of both nozzles from the factory, there were zero adhesion issues. Overall, I have to say that I'm incredibly impressed with the KiDiTech X-Pro. Based on my testing, I think that the KiDiTech X-Pro is the perfect machine for anyone looking to get into multi-material printing, or those that are looking to buy a machine that simply works out of the box. The KiDiTech X-Pro definitely gets the Super Make Something seal of approval, and will surely be used in many future projects that require multi-material 3D printing.
Multi-material 3D printing is a fantastic rapid prototyping tool that allows makers to make more complicated projects at home compared to what is possible with single material printers. A big thank you to KiDiTech for sending the X-Pro to me for this video. In case you're interested in picking up your own X-Pro to experiment with multi-material printing, links to where this printer can be purchased online can be found in the video description below. If you enjoyed this video and found it useful, please consider giving it a like, sharing it with your friends, and subscribing to my channel. Also, be sure to click the bell icon to be notified when I upload my next video. I also recently started a Patreon page, which is another great way to support the channel and to help me make more videos. Being a patron comes with several perks, which you can check out by following the link in the video description. Well, that's all there is to this episode. Thanks for watching. Now go super make something.
Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please be sure to hit the like button and share it with your friends. Your support helps me make more episodes. Links to all project files can be found in the video description below. Click the subscribe button on the left to keep up with my latest projects. Click the cards on the right to check out more episodes and connect with me on social media. Thanks again for watching. Now go super make something.